We light the first two Advent candles for hope and for peace. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. We light this next candle to remember the joy of God's blessing. God invites us to the festival of the kingdom, where there is no more death, sadness, crying, or pain. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again. Rejoice.
The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, and release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favour, and the day of vengeance for our God, to comfort all who mourn, and provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. They will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendour. They will rebuild the ancient ruins and restore the places long devastated. They will renew ruined cities that have been devastated for generations.
I delight greatly in the Lord. My soul rejoices in my God. For he has clothed me with garments of salvation and arrayed me in a robe of his righteousness. As a bridegroom adorns his head like a priest, and as a bride adorns herself with jewels, for as the soil makes the sprout come up, and a garden causes seeds to grow, so the Sovereign Lord will make righteousness and praise spring up before all nations.
Hello, and a warm welcome to our online service for this, the third Sunday in Advent 2020. Can you believe it? And it's also the fourth and final Sunday in our four-part series considering the Methodist Way of Life initiative. Part of me wants to call it simply the Christian way of life, as that's what I believe it to be. In previous weeks, we firstly considered with Colin what living life as a follower of Jesus means with respect to learning and caring. Juliet shared her thoughts on worship and prayer and what worship means in its largest sense and creative ways of engaging in prayer. And last week, Jonna took the theme of service and the story of the Good Samaritan and what it means to live a life not of self-serving and it being all about us, but instead embracing a way of life that is lived out for others, for the good of God's kingdom. And today we consider the fourth and final area, that of evangelism. The word strikes fear into the heart of many of us. What does it actually mean? Where does the word come from, and why is it included in what it means to live a life following Jesus? My prayer is that as we share in this time today, we might get a fresh appreciation for what is at the very heart of the message of Jesus, why it's good news, and why proclaiming that good news is, I believe, still vitally important. Of course, getting the proper sense of a message is necessary too, and sometimes these newfangled automatic subtitling systems that are getting more common in online material, well, sometimes they don't always get it right, as happened twice during an Advent service from Guildford Cathedral just last week. First, proclamations were made in regard to that well-known Roman governor, Pontius Pilate. And a little later on during communion, they confidently prayed their prayers in the power of the spinach. Popeye would be very proud, I'm sure. Technology might trip us up sometimes, but I, for one, am very grateful for what it has allowed us to do in recent months and how it's helped to keep us connected. Imagine this pandemic taking place just 30 years ago and how much more limited we would have been. From the new now to the very old, I invite us to share now in a prayer together, which begins with a powerful declaration of faith that dates back 800 years or so from St. Francis of Assisi. Let's pray. You are holy, Lord, the only God, and your deeds are wonderful. You are love. You are wisdom. You are humility. You are endurance. You are rest. You are peace. You are joy and gladness. You are all our riches, and you suffice for us. You are beauty. You are gentleness. You are our protector. You are our guardian and defender. You are courage. You are our haven and hope. You are our faith, our great consolation. You are our eternal life, great and wonderful Lord, God Almighty, merciful Saviour. Lord, we thank you for your goodness and your grace, and your faithfulness to us in these difficult times. And on this third Sunday in Advent, we thank you, Lord Jesus, that you emptied yourself of all the glories of heaven and came to dwell among us, the Word becoming flesh, to fulfill that prophecy of Isaiah in proclaiming good news to the poor and poor in all kinds of different ways, and release to the captives, release from all different kinds of things that bind us. We remember, Lord, also that having been born on this earth within the limitations of human form, lying in a manger, you stooped yet further to die the death of a common criminal on a cross. And through your sacrificial and obedient love, you are now raised up, exalted, and given the name that is above every name, that every knee may bow and every tongue confess that you are Saviour, Lord, and King of Kings. Lord, we know that of ourselves we are not worthy to stand in your presence because of our own propensity to sin in the thoughts of our heads, the words of our mouths, and often in our deeds too. We echo the words of Isaiah, who, when faced with your countenance and glory, confessed, "I am a man of unclean lips and live among a people of unclean lips." And so, with repentant hearts, we too want to say sorry for the way we are sometimes, for our misplaced and thoughtless words that can hurt, our actions that divide instead of unite. Lord, like Isaiah, touch our lips and our hearts that we might both speak and live in a way that reflects your goodness and your glory and proclaims the good news about Jesus. And in his precious name we pray. Amen.
Israel's strength and born a child and yet a king, born to reign in us forever. Now thy gracious kingdom reign by thine own eternal spirit.
The reading is taken from John chapter 12, commencing at verse 37, and the heading, "The Jews Continue in Their Unbelief." Even after Jesus had done all these miraculous signs in their presence, they still would not believe in him. This was to fulfill the word of Isaiah the prophet. "Lord, who has believed our message? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed?" For this reason they could not believe, because, as Isaiah says elsewhere, "He has blinded their eyes, deadened their hearts, so they can neither see with their eyes, nor understand with their hearts, nor turn, and I would heal them." I have said this because he saw Jesus' glory and he spoke about him. Yet at the same time, many, even among the leaders, believed in him. But because of the Pharisees, they would not confess their faith, for fear they would be put out of the synagogue. For they loved praise from men more than praise from God. Then Jesus cried out, "When a man believes in me, he does not believe in me only, but in the one who sent me. When he looks at me, he sees the one who sent me. I have come into the world as a light, so that no one who believes in me should stay in darkness. As for the person who hears my words, but does not keep them, I do not judge him. For I did not come to judge the world, but to save it. There is a judge for the one who rejects me and does not accept my words. That very word which I spoke will condemn him at the very last day. For I did not speak of my own accord, but the Father who sent me commanded me what to say and how to say it. I know that his command leads to eternal life. So whatever I say is just what the Father has told me to say." Amen.
News is all around us, isn't it? Have you ever sat waiting in eager anticipation of some significant news or a message coming through about something important? I'm sure you will have. In recent months, of course, the whole world was eagerly awaiting an announcement that was going to change things and bring some hope. And then the news broke that everyone had been waiting for.
Bit of breaking news we can bring you about COVID-19.
A major breakthrough has been announced in the development of a vaccine for coronavirus.
We've cleared one significant hurdle, but there are several more to go.
The world's leading scientists have expressed their delight, along with a strong note of caution, following the news that a vaccine against coronavirus has proved 90% effective in early results.
Upon this announcement, even stock markets went haywire. Stocks climbed for things like airlines that had been so hard hit as the news of a possible COVID-19 vaccine broke. People could finally start to anticipate that this virus nightmare was, in time, going to come to an end. The world was changed by that message bearing hope. As we approach Christmas once again at the end of this difficult year, we remember 2,000 years ago when a message of great hope about the coming of the Messiah was proclaimed by those strange angelic beings to some, no doubt, very nervous ordinary shepherds on a hillside. The world was being changed forever by that message too. But all this time later, why is Jesus still good news today? Why is the message still important to share? Well, because I, for one, believe that the good news about Jesus and what he did for us is still changing lives today. At the time of the early church, much of the world was being ruled by the military might of the Romans under the emperorship of Caesar. Caesar had inaugurated a 12-day celebration of his birth called the Advent of Caesar. And when Caesar wanted to send out a message to let everybody know about his latest accomplishments, he would send out a royal pronouncement, which in the Greek language were known as evangelions, which is where our English word evangelical comes from. So from the very beginning of the early church, evangelism, or spreading the good news message about Jesus, has always been a key part of a life that seeks to share Jesus with others. But just what is that message exactly? We hear now a passage from one of the letters that St. Paul wrote to the early believers at Corinth, where he writes about what he tirelessly proclaims and why the message always provokes such controversy.
This reading is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 18 to 31. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, the intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate. Where is the wise person? Where is the teacher of the law? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God the world through its wisdom did not know him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. Jews demand signs and Greeks look for wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. Brothers and sisters, think of what you were when you were called. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were influential. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. God chose the lowly things of this world and the despised things, and the things that are not, to nullify the things that are, so that no one may boast before him. It is because of him that you are in Christ Jesus, who has become for us wisdom from God, that is, our righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Therefore, as it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord.
A big crowd was following. Just a few of Jesus' friends were following. And Jesus became weakened by the loss of blood, and he fell. And so Simon of Cyrene, an African, helped him carry the cross. The soldiers went quickly and methodically about their task of driving home the nails in his hands and the spike through his feet. The crowd mills around jeering. He saved others. Himself he cannot save. They laughed and they mocked and they made fun of him. Come down. Do just one more miracle, they said. But he didn't do it. He stayed there. And you know why he stayed there? Because of you. Because he loved you. Because, you see, only in Jesus Christ can we find forgiveness of sins. He was bearing our sins on the cross.
How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one of whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them? Faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word about Christ.
On a wet, slightly foggy, dull night in May 1984 at Roker Park Stadium in Sunderland, a teenage boy, along with tens of thousands of others, heard a very simple message preached about the love of God shown to us through the cross of Jesus and its power to save. And then a challenge given that just as Jesus called people publicly, then so this crowd too should respond publicly in committing lives to Jesus and to believe in that saving message of the cross. It was slightly uncomfortable, it was a little bit nerve-wracking, but the teenage boy responded to the challenge and went forward to make that commitment. He'd been part of a Methodist church most of his life through his family heritage, but felt that he'd never been challenged really like that before. And as he travelled home that evening in the coach, he sensed a deep peace that he'd not felt before. And the stuff that he'd heard about Jesus over the years seemed to move from an intellectual head knowledge to a heart knowledge that then shaped that boy's life from there on in. That simple message about the cross of Christ was preached by probably the best known evangelist of modern times, Billy Graham. And of course, that certain teenage lad was me. In many ways, the reading we had from 1 Corinthians represents yet another paradox in the scriptures, like so many others. Jesus' challenge that to find real life, first you have to let go of it. So many such topsy-turvy statements that you find relating to the kingdom of God. The last shall be first. He who wants to be the greatest must become the least. And then from this reading in Paul's letter to the church at Corinth, here we go with another paradox that's associated with the central truth of Christianity. The paradox that the message of the cross that contains within it the life-changing wisdom and power of God, to some people will be judged as complete foolishness by the normal standards of what the world calls wise. The wisest message with eternal consequences will seem to some completely foolish and even offensive. The city of Corinth was in southern Greece, about 45 miles west of Athens, and it was fully immersed in the Greek culture. Corinth was by far the crown jewel of liberal arts education from the academies there. And the golden-tongued Greek orators there really were the kind of elevated celebrities of their day, often held in higher esteem than even champion athletes, and placed on the highest pedestals in Greek culture. Those people of first century Greece loved polished eloquence in public speech. They idolised those who excelled in that art of persuasion and public discourse. Throughout the Roman Empire, such eloquence in speech was a primary form of entertainment. The art of the orator was to win over his audience through various techniques of rhetoric and reason and persuasion and delivery, always seeking to win the audience with the command of language and his way with words. And only if the orators could hold their listeners spellbound were they deemed to be successful. And so as a result, when the Apostle Paul came to Corinth to preach the message of the cross, the people there began to measure him up against the standards of the Greek orator. And quite frankly, they found him to be, well, lacking. His physical appearance was unimpressive. His stage presence was less than captivating. Paul really was out of his league by the oratorical standards of the day. Those sophisticated listeners were accustomed to holding court on those who they listened to, expecting beautiful speech and expecting to be mesmerised and hypnotised by them. And by Paul's own admission in the next chapter, he says that he was without superiority of speech. He fell well short of the verbal sophistication that people were used to. But Paul didn't so much see himself as any kind of golden-tongued orator, but instead as a faithful herald. A herald was someone who was commissioned by the Roman Empire to be dispatched from Caesar to the outer limits of the empire and to go into a village and stand in the marketplace and gather the people around him to make a declaration, to bring an announcement. The herald would lift up his voice and say, "Good news from the throne of Caesar." These tidings of good news in Greek were the euangelions I mentioned earlier. A message of good news delivered by a herald. And a herald was not results oriented. A herald was obedience oriented. Did the herald faithfully convey the message that had been entrusted to them, irrespective of whether or not the listeners responded to the message they heard? The success of a herald was entirely different to that of the orator, who was measured by style points, whereas a herald was measured according to their faithfulness to the message to be delivered. And the message was not to be altered in order to try and get a better hearing and a better response. And Paul's preaching about Jesus, his life, death, and resurrection, gets a somewhat mixed response from its hearers. And the cross, in particular, proves to be a stumbling block. Jesus' cross is a bloody cross. It's an offensive message because it's a shameful death. And to many hearers, it's actually a distasteful announcement that Paul, the herald, brings. And Paul writes that the message of the cross is foolishness to some. The foolishness here is the Greek word moros, from which we get our word moron. This is a moronic message to some hearers. Nonsense, folly, pointless, irrelevant. That is what the cross is to the natural person, unless the Holy Spirit has enlivened their heart to the power of that message. And why can the preaching of the cross seem so foolish? Well, because crucifixion was a horrible and shameful death, reserved for only the worst criminals, for murderers and insurrectionists. It was so violent, in fact, that no Roman citizen could be crucified. And what the gospel says is that God became a man, and he became a lowly carpenter, and he was subjected to the most ignominious death known to man. The shame of the cross. and he was crucified publicly and lifted up to die as an enemy of the Roman Empire. And what the foolishness of the cross says is that every man and every woman's eternal destiny is determined by their relationship to this cross. And Paul says that for those who are being saved, this bonkers and foolish message of the cross to them represents the very power of God, and a message containing all the rich truth about the grace of God. And Paul, the herald of this message, talks about God essentially frustrating conventional wisdom and choosing the most important life-changing truth of all to be something that many would consider, on the face of it, completely foolish and sometimes even offensive. But in this passage, Paul elevates that message to take absolute centre stage and make it the greatest wisdom that anyone could embrace. But why didn't God choose a way that could be discovered through conventional wisdom? I've got friends who are very bright, clever people in every normal sense of the word, and they're searching. It's obvious that they're searching, but they're looking for the clever argument that clinches the case for Christian faith for them. They're wanting to hear the sort of killer rational point of view that appears to be a better argument than the various main tenets of no faith put forward by what we often call these days the new atheists. Why didn't God choose a way that could be found perhaps by the application of finely honed human intellect? Well, because for one, you would need to be wise, maybe even clever in the conventional sense, to discover it and to partake of it. And God doesn't play it that way. No, God chose a message that needs to be perceived with a different kind of wisdom that is not apparent to the wider world, a kind of wisdom that can often be seen by many as sheer foolishness, by some even childish perhaps. Maybe that's why Jesus looked upon little children who came to him and declared that the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these. Finely honed intellect is not required to perceive and embrace the greatest wisdom of all, the very power of God to save, in the message of the cross of Christ. And this gospel message, this Evangelion, is to be preached and witnessed to throughout the world. Now, to wrestle with a slightly thorny issue of what so often seems to be the tension between gospel preaching and words on the one side of the fence and doing and serving on the other side, between speaking a gospel message and doing kingdom deeds. When we look at our four areas of the Methodist way of life, there's perhaps a temptation to say, well, we do the evangelism bit by doing the service. We don't talk about Jesus and the cross as such. We don't want to put people off. So we'll just be Jesus through acts of service. And well, people will get the idea, hopefully. There's a much used quote that's usually attributed to the great St. Francis of Assisi, whose beautiful prayer we used earlier. He's often quoted as saying, "Preach the gospel at all times. If necessary, use words." It's catchy, and I've quoted it myself from time to time. However, I think there is a danger that it can be heard as, "Only resort to words if absolutely necessary." This when we're entrusted with a message that was to be proclaimed about the cross of Christ that Paul called the very power of God to save. As it happens, there's no real evidence to suggest that the great man St. Francis ever actually said it. None of his fellow Franciscans or biographers quote him ever saying it, and it doesn't show up in any of his own writings either. The closest St. Francis comes is in his Rule of 1221, chapter 12, on how the Franciscans should practice their preaching, where he writes, "No brother should preach contrary to the form and regulations of the Holy Church, nor unless he has been permitted by his minister. All the friars should preach by their deeds." Essentially, what St. Francis actually said then was to make sure that deeds done match words proclaimed about faith. But of the message of the cross, St. Paul says, "How then can they call on the one they have not believed in? And how can they believe in the one of whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them, without telling them? And then he concludes that faith comes from hearing the message, and the message is heard through the word about Christ. Please understand what I'm not saying here. I'm not saying that living out the gospel in deeds and sacrificially serving those in need is not vitally important too. It is vitally important. In fact, the book of James says, suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food, if one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm and well fed, but does nothing about their physical needs, what good is it? Faith, when it's not accompanied by works, is dead, said James. Well, amen to that, certainly, because a faith that doesn't shape outward action is not a living faith at all. But if we remove the message of the cross of Christ because it might offend, or more likely because it might be embarrassing for us, then we strip our faith of the message that I believe contains within it the very power of God to save. And we as a church become simply a good humanitarian organisation alongside many others. And if we don't even manage the good works of outward service either, then we're not even a good humanitarian organisation. As a church together, we become just a kind of benign club that looks after its own. I heard of a church a few years back that was visited by a deacon in training. Can't remember where, perhaps just as well. The church was faced with closure, and so very laudably it took the bold step of trying to revitalise its church building to better serve the community around it. All good stuff. And the community embraced the project, and after a few years and a lot of hard graft and sacrifice amongst the members of the congregation, this church building was a hive of activity all week. Loads of people from the community coming into it and using this wonderfully refurbished church building for all sorts of activities. It got lots of community-based funding for all the good stuff going on there. But this visiting deacon said, but you know, I'm concerned because all this good work has been done and all these people are turning up there through the week. But there's almost no connection between all these groups and any sense of the primary reason why the building is there at all. So for all the work and for all the apparent success of the project, the message of the cross of Christ that has the power to save was barely even brushing against all those people from the community that were now pouring in week by week. St. Paul became so convinced about the power of the message about Jesus and the cross in and of itself that he didn't even care about the motives of whoever was preaching it. Some preach Christ out of self-ambition, he once admitted, out of envy and rivalry. But then he suggests, but what does it matter? The important thing is that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached. And because of this, I rejoice, he said. When Paul wrote another letter to the early followers of Jesus at Ephesus, he asked them to pray also for me, that whenever I speak, words may be given me, so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should. The message of the cross of Christ, however jarring and foolish it will seem to some, has to be at the centre of all the serving we do. And we do people a grave disservice, if you pardon the pun, by choosing that it's not necessary to speak and to bear witness to the message of the cross and to just quietly do things instead. It's a message that will seem foolish to some, but in the upside-down world of God's kingdom, we're foolish to be wise. We're called to embrace and proclaim this fool's gold of a message about the cross, because it contains within it the very power of God to save. And yes, we're also called to a life of sacrificial service and caring too, because a living faith in Jesus will always be seen in outward actions as well. We can't all be Billy Grahams, of course. In fact, I don't think any of us could be, including me. But we don't have to be. Just like Paul, who didn't see himself as eloquent in any way, we can ask the Holy Spirit to give us the right words to share with people. And we might be really surprised at the result, as in God's power, we become heralds too. And once we've discovered Jesus and the power of his cross for ourselves and begun that exciting journey of following him, then another really important part of evangelism is simply sharing with folks how a life with Jesus is making a difference to us. Never underestimate the power of the simplest of little faith stories shared with someone else. When we find the courage to do it, it can be an amazing witness to Jesus that comes along for someone else at just the right time and resonates with them in just the right way. That happens so often, and I believe it's no accident. That's the Holy Spirit at work, going ahead of us and putting the right words in our mouths at just the right time for someone else who is searching. Sharing our journeys of faith with others in an honest and authentic way can so often be the starting point for others. Research conducted in the late 20th century showed that over 75% of Christians said they came to faith through a friend or a relative. I'm very aware of how many different people, both near and far, are sharing in these online services, and that is such a joy and a real privilege. But it's also a big responsibility for those of us that lead these services. If Billy Graham were still here with us, he would ask the pointed question that many thousands of people were challenged with over the course of his lifetime of evangelism. And I think it would be remiss of me to lead a service about evangelism and not ask the same question, the one that Billy Graham would never omit to ask. What does the cross of Jesus really mean to you? Have you made a conscious decision for Christ? The message of the cross is that all your sins and mess-ups, everything that can separate you from a right relationship with God, Jesus invites you to trust in him, to take all of that sin upon himself on the cross. That's the free gift. That's the good news, the gospel. We can't earn our way into heaven. None of us will ever be good enough by our own efforts. Jesus went to the cross not carrying any sins of his own, but ours, because he loved and loves each and every one of us. He was sinless. We are sinful. But Jesus invites us to repent, to turn from our old ways, and to trust in him. Through the cross of Jesus, we find peace with God and peace with ourselves. Responding to that challenge and the message of the cross preached by the herald Billy Graham certainly changed my life. I pray that the message of the cross of Jesus changes your life too. Once when Jesus was describing himself as the good shepherd, he also said, "My sheep hear my voice." Some Bible versions say, "My sheep recognize my voice. I know them and they follow me. I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand." Part of Psalm 95 declares, "We are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand." And then it goes on to say, "Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts." If your heart has been nudged today, I can't invite you to step out of your seats and come forward like Billy Graham would have done, but I can lead you in a very simple little prayer. They're not magic words, but prayers along similar lines have represented at least the starting point of a journey of following Jesus for so many people who have responded to his call. So if you feel that this is right for you today, then wherever you are, I invite you to share in an intentional and focused way in this little prayer. Let's pray. Dear Lord Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner and I ask for your forgiveness. I believe you died for my sins and rose from the dead. I turn from my sins and invite you to come into my heart and my life. I want to trust and follow you as my Lord and Saviour. Lord, please continue to reveal yourself to me as I commit to love, to follow, and to serve you. In your precious name I pray. Amen. We share now in a new song as we proclaim Jesus as our King, the one who left the glories of heaven to a cradle in the dirt, to the cross, and then on to the glorious resurrection. We sing King of Kings.
Resurrected me. Here are our prayers of intercession. There will be a bidding and a response, which will be shown on the screen. Let us pray. Blessed are you, Lord our God, for you are both powerful and wise. From you comes our life and all that we have and are. We welcome you into our lives. Blessed are you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Let us pray for the witness and message of the Church in the world and in our local communities. Let us thank God that we do have something to say, a message to declare. We ask your blessing on all who seek to proclaim the good news to the whole world and to us in our church communities. Let us thank God that we have those who do proclaim your message, those who seek to evangelize, our preachers and our ministers of the word and sacraments. We ask your blessing on the mission of the Church to bring your word to all who would hear it. Let him who boasts, boast in the name of the Lord. Lord, we ask your blessing on all who contribute to the sum of human knowledge. Yet the wisdom of God makes all accumulated human wisdom foolish. In our foolishness, we pray that we will come to know you more clearly, to love you more dearly, as we listen to your word, brought to us by those you have led by the Spirit, to guide us, to strengthen us in our weakness, that your will be done on earth. Let him who boasts, boast in the name of the Lord. Lord, we pray for those in positions of great responsibility and for those who are concerned for others. We pray for the leaders of nations and governments as they struggle to control the pandemic which afflicts your world. We pray for those who are lonely or frightened, for those who have lost homes and livelihoods. We pray for those who are concerned for their future in the decisions made about Brexit. In all things, we pray for justice and fair dealing. Let him who boasts, boast in the name of the Lord. Lord, we pray your blessing on all who work in our hospitals and care homes, those who work in the community to care for others. We also remember before you all who are poor or homeless, for those who are depressed or struggling with life, those who are ill at home or in hospital. We pray for our loved ones who have departed from us. We pray that they all may glorify your name. Let him who boasts, boast in the name of the Lord. We pray that you will guide the scientists and medical staff who have developed and are distributing the vaccine. May they feel uplifted by you, strengthened by you if they become weak and weary. We pray that you may give them a little of your wisdom. And we pray for those who wait for the vaccine, may wait in patience, secure in the knowledge that the hope they experience comes from you. Let him who boasts, boast in the name of the Lord. These prayers we bring in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who gives us righteousness, holiness, and redemption. Amen. And now let us say together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespass, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
Thanks to Lynn there for leading us in our prayers of intercession and the Lord's Prayer. And thanks also to Nat Cole from Denton Burn, who read our reading from John earlier. And also to my family, to Trudy, to Ben and to Emma for taking part in this service too. We sing our final hymn together for this service today. This one's in the Mission and Evangelism section of Singing the Faith. We have a gospel to proclaim, good news for all throughout the earth, the gospel of a Saviour's name. We sing his glory, tell his worth. Let's sing.
We have a gospel to proclaim.
Good to share with you today. But now our final blessing. So friends, go in peace, in the power of the Holy Spirit, to witness to the powerful message of the cross and to live a life of learning and caring and worship and service that matches our Evangelion, our good news message. And the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with us all evermore. Amen.
Some say this night.
But the treasures of this life will slowly turn to dust, and this fool will find his gold in the Savior that I trust. Fool's gold, it's waiting in a crown. Fool's gold, in a city coming down. I'll leave the gold I can't afford for the higher prize I'm pressing toward. I'll preach the foolish cross of Christ and wait for my reward. Fool's gold, the wisdom of the cross is easy to receive, but only foolishness to them.